how do we grow in autonomy and independence if we're not given room to do so? It really comes down to Ariel wants independence and she wants to be respected, and Triton just wants his daughter to be safe. Ariel was out of balance. Both her body dysmorphia and hoarding is tied back to dissatisfaction. With the life I have, with the look I have, I want to make it different, or I want to cling to the past, or I want to build towards a different future. She wasn't satisfied with the fins. She didn't truly love herself. She wasn't okay with who she was. The best treatment for both of those is to focus on finding a balance between the life that you want and the life that you have. Part of that
world. She's 16. Is he just a dog parent?
Not unless he's like, time to pair her off for life.
That's what it seems like.
Maybe she's halfway through her life. How long do fish last? A couple years?
Welcome to Cinema Therapy. I am Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker. I need therapy.
And I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist, and I love movies.
And he's an NPR radio host. I'm excited to take you on this journey through cinema and feeling.
Roger, if I were using that microscope right now, I still wouldn't be able to locate my interest in your problem.
What is our journey of cinema and feelings today?
Well, today I'm going to have you react, as you often do as a therapist, to a film.
Yes.
And this film that I'm going to have you react to.
Why do you talk the way you talk?
I hate so much about the things that you choose to be.
What are we watching?
I'm gonna have you react to a timeless gem, a classic. I'm gonna have you react to The Little Mermaid.
Wonderful.
It's a Disney film, you may have heard of it.
Yes, I already have thoughts.
You may have felt things about it as a young man.
I can neither confirm nor deny these reports. But
Gandalf, thanks for joining us.
They were fishy feelings.
Everybody felt a little fishy for a while there. King Triton was looking good.
I'm excited to see what clips you pull.
Look at this stuff.
The I Want song.
Wouldn't you think my collection's complete? Wouldn't you think I'm the girl who has?
So I've seen this movie a lot, obviously, because I was a child in the 90s.
And you have children now?
And I have children now.
They have watched it a bit?
I have two daughters and three sisters. There's been a lot of this in my life.
Sure.
So she's looking at,
Sure.
Right now I'm thinking hoarding. Right
out the gate, we're going to talk about hoarding.
Yes.
Okay, I was going to ask you about relationship stuff, but that's fascinating.
Well,
I mean, this is hoarding behaviors.
Well, so hoarding...
Or is it collecting? What's the difference?
Okay, here's the difference between hoarding and collecting, just like the difference between any disorder and a regular average behavior, is how much it affects your life.
Got it. Okay.
Right? So her collection is a secret. So it's driving a wedge potentially between her and her father because she can't reveal it.
I could see an argument for hoarding then.
I would say that in a normal home, hoarding takes up way too much space. She's got endless space. She's got caves and caverns, but still it just goes on and on.
Jumping, dancing, strolling along down a...
She's also talking about how legs are required for jumping and dancing and how she wants legs.
Yeah.
And so there's another thing that I've been thinking about for years as I've watched this movie.
Are you going to go for body dysmorphia?
Body dysmorphia, nailed it. So body dysmorphia is a fixation on a body part that you perceive as imperfect or ugly, that others don't perceive it that way or think it's no big deal or don't even notice.
Right.
Classic. I always love that little noise he makes. And so, I mean, there's definitely, she wants a different life than she has, which is pretty standard, you know, for these types of films.
Sure.
But she very specifically wants legs. She is kind of disgusted by her fins or not really into her fins. And so she's going to go with body dysmorphia. You're willing to go to great lengths to make a change.
Right.
Right? Right? She's ready to stand. And so, and then go back to hoarding. Hoarding is about, it's holding on to a life. Most people hoard and they're holding on backwards. They're holding on to the stuff that's come before, keepsakes, newspaper clippings, wrappers, movie ticket stubs, like 1,000 things, and just piles up until you go to their house and it's just a huge mess.
And there's dead rats in there.
And there's dead rats behind 7-foot-high stacks of National Geographic magazines and stuff like that, right? For her, it's not looking backwards, it's looking forward. It's the life that she wants. This entire room, this entire cave, is a giant vision board. Like, you ever create a vision board of what you want your life to look like, and you pull, like, a few pictures, like, stock images of, like, I want to have these abs, I want to have this house. So this entire thing, she's hoarding, but for a different, not a different reason. It's about the life she wants. But most people, the life they want is behind them. And they're, you know, try not to forget. Oh, Sebastian.
I hadn't seen this movie in a long time.
Yeah.
And surprise, surprise, the animators at Disney, still, they just really nailed the physical comedy.
Yeah.
It's really good.
Yeah, it's wonderful. I love revisiting things as an adult and catching little jokes and things that you never caught before.
Or just didn't appreciate. Like, I laughed at all of the physical comedy stuff when I was a kid, but I didn't appreciate how hard it was to do.
Yeah.
And it still holds up.
Yeah.
What, 35 years later, 30 years later? Like, it's good.
Yeah.
Thank you to Helix Sleep for sponsoring this nap time. As you know, Helix Sleep makes premium mattresses and bedding that are customized to fit your needs.
Everybody's different, and Helix knows that.
Some people have fish butts, some people have butt butts.
They made the sleep quiz to match your unique body type and sleep preferences to make the perfect mattress for you.
They have something for everybody's taste.
I took the sleep quiz together with my wife to find a mattress that's the perfect compromise for both of us.
She's a woman, he's a fish. That's how you get merbabies.
I'm a back sleeper, and my wife is a side sleeper, and we both like our mattresses medium firm.
That's how I like my le poisson.
So Helix matched us with the perfect mattress for us, which was the Helix Midnight mattress, based on our results.
The best part is that Helix delivers your mattress right to your door for free within the US.
It comes rolled up in a box, and it's super easy to set up yourself, like super easy. Like, I had no problems with it. I've had my Helix mattress for a few weeks, and what I like most about it is that the medium is the perfect firmness for me, because too soft and my back hurts, and too firm and my back hurts.
There are financing options and flexible payment plans.
We're so in love and we're family. I love being your papa.
With your Helix Sleep mattress, you get a 100-night sleep trial along with a 10-year warranty.
That is more than 3 months to determine whether or not you like it. And if you don't, Helix Sleep will take you back to their cave and turn you into a weird jellyfish wall monster.
No.
No, they'll pick it up and you get a full refund.
Yes. I love my Helix and I think that you will too.
Fish butt.
Who are you calling fish butt? Shark bait?
Shark bait.
Ooh ha ha.
You're so stupid.
If you're looking for a new bed, check out Helix. Click on the link below or go to helixsleep.com/cinematherapy for up to $200 off your Helix Sleep mattress plus 2 free pillows.
That's so many pillows. There's two more than I have right now.
The channel's doing okay. Spring for some pillows.
No, I currently have some. That's just 2 more than I have.
Math. The final frontier. So both body dysmorphia and hoarding oftentimes just tie back to dissatisfaction. With the life I have, with the look I have, I want to make it different, or I want to cling to the past, or I want to build towards a different future. And again, all of that can be healthy. I mean, I want to improve my life. I want to improve my health. Like, that can all be healthy. What makes something a disorder is how much it negatively impacts your living or your thinking or your relationships. And in Ariel's case, she's missing out on
her whole potential life.
She's keeping secrets from her dad.
And, you know, I would argue she's doing that stupidly.
Stupid! You're so stupid!
For a boy she's never met or spoken to and has looked at a couple times.
Here's the thing, though. I will argue, and we poo-poo on Little Mermaid, but she is a teenager, and teenagers are exactly like that.
Oh, yeah. No, I
was like that. For sure.
100%. Where the story really, really falls apart for me is Triton's reaction to it.
But then the seagull came, and it was this is this, and that is that.
Seagull? What? Oh, you went up to the surface again, didn't you? Didn't you?
Nothing happened.
Oh, Ariel, how many times must we go through this? You could have been seen by one of those barbarians, by one of those humans.
Daddy, they're not barbarians.
They're dangerous. Do you think I want to see my youngest daughter snared by some fish eater's hook?
I'm 16 years old. I'm not a child.
Don't you take that tone of voice with me, young lady. Well, as long as you live under my ocean, you'll obey my rules.
But if you would just listen.
Not another word. And I am never, never to hear of you going to the surface again. Is that clear?
Oh, not the best parenting, Triton.
Nope. And he knows it.
Yeah.
Teenagers, they think they know everything. You give them an inch, they swim all over you.
Do you think I was too hard on her?
The answer is yes. And Sebastian is a crab.
What? I know he's Triton, but he's essentially Poseidon. He's essentially the god of the ocean.
Yeah.
And his counselor is a crab who's lived maybe 2 years.
Right.
You know, and seen some bubbles.
A good composer, apparently. Neat. Doesn't qualify him to help you with parenting.
I remember watching this as a kid, and when she says, I'm 16, I'm not a child, I'm like, absolutely.
Well, yeah, when I was a kid, you know, this came out when we were, what, 6 or 7, maybe
yeah,
8 years
89,
old?
Yeah, 89, I think.
Yeah, I was like, yeah, she's a grown-up, she's 16, she's got this. And then, you know, looking at 16-year-olds now from the other side of 40, it's like, shut the hell up. You don't know what you're talking about. Go to your room.
So this is the constant push and pull of parent versus child, because when you're born and then you're an infant and a child, you're completely dependent, and your parent are the absolute authority, and they teach you how the world works.
Right, absolutely.
Right? And so you don't really have a lot of autonomy. You do what you're told, or, I mean, a lot of kids don't do what they're told, but they know that their parents are ultimately, like, the authority figures who know how the world works, right? At least that's how we perceive our parents.
Right.
And then as you grow older, you're approaching adulthood, but you're not there yet. But you're looking for more independence, and that's natural.
And 16 is really close.
It's on the cusp.
You're right on the cusp of adulthood at that point.
Yeah. And you've experienced at least some things by now, and you've read some books. And the what's the phrase that you like to use about people who...
Oh, the Dunning-Kruger effect.
Yeah, tell us about the Dunning-Kruger effect.
Yeah, so the Dunning-Kruger effect is once you learn a little bit about something, you immediately perceive your knowledge of that thing to be really, really high. And then the more you learn about it, the more you realize, oh, I know almost nothing about this.
Yeah.
And then you start to really become an expert. But that's years and years of, like, study and effort and whatever. After taking a Psych 101 class, you probably felt pretty great about yourself.
I'm like, look at all this stuff that I know that my friends and family don't know.
And then the further you got into your master's program, you were probably like,
oh, yeah.
I got a ways to go.
It's very true.
This was me with film, right? I watched movies growing up. I took a film class in college. I could definitely make a movie. The further we got into making our movie in college, the more I was like, I don't know what the hell I'm doing.
Oh, dude! Come on, run it off!
I just got hit by a car!
That's definitely true of my education, and I also think the Dunning-Kruger effect perfectly describes every adolescent I've ever met in my life.
Yes.
And when you talk about, you learn a little more and you realize how little you know, that's people, a lot of us entering our 20s.
Mm-hmm. I was slow on that. It took until my late 20s
started. Into your 30s, you're realizing how little you know, and then hopefully you spend the rest of your life in some sort of humility.
40s, 50s, and 60s, you start really becoming an expert at the thing you're an expert in, and you're very humble about everything else.
Yeah, and even then, like, I love hearing stories about Spielberg approaching young filmmakers, asking them how they got a certain shot or how they pulled off a certain thing, and it's I just think that's wonderful that he's Spielberg and he's still learning.
He's always a student. Yeah.
Yeah. So here's this place where Triton is looking at Ariel and he's like, you could get spear hooked. I mean, I think that's a great metaphor for a parent worried about their child falling in love with the wrong sort. For him, it's humans, right?
Yeah.
But if we go bigger, it's just, I'm afraid of you falling in love with somebody who's going to hurt you.
Right.
Right? Here it's literal. They will spear you or hook you. But Triton's worried about Ariel making not the best choice. And in some ways, he doesn't trust her. And in some ways, that's valid.
100%.
She's running on sheer hormones and thinks she knows more than she does. But the flip side of that is that how do we grow in autonomy and independence if we're not given room to do so?
Right. And he is definitely not listening.
Yeah.
In this scene at all.
So let's talk about what the better approach would be. Because he is silencing her and he's expecting her to bow to his parental authority, and when that doesn't work, he gets bigger, louder, meaner.
Yeah.
All that's going to do is exactly what happens in the film. She rebels behind his back, and it's far better as a parent to say, okay, I understand this is something that you want. Let's talk about where you're at in life and how much of this is probably a good idea for you to have, and what do you think some good guidelines are? Because I thought I was in love at 16.
Sure.
And I wasn't. At least, I wasn't.
No.
No, that's not what that was. But I was so wrapped up in the passion and the intensity of it. Had my parents tried to stop it, I guarantee it would have gone
worse. It would have gone badly, yeah.
So instead, they sat down and they say, these feelings are very real, and we're excited for you to be experiencing this for the first time.
This is great.
Let's talk about...
boundaries, rules.
Yeah, yeah. And even though they had final say, they let me be an active voice in shaping things. And there were certain things that they made concessions on where they wanted me to do this. And I'm like, I would rather go this far. And they say, I'd rather have this be the boundary. And they say, okay. And allowing me to have an active voice in it meant that I respected their authority more.
Sure.
Because it was a partnership instead of them just like enforcing, which is what Triton does here.
Yeah.
But dude looks great for his age.
Dude, if I can look like that. Well, and what's his age? He's got a 16-year-old daughter. I mean,
he could be 900 and still procreating. It's different under the sea. Yes. Everything's better down where it's wetter.
Oh. That's why it's hotter.
Of course, I had hoped it would be a wedding present.
Oh, come on, Grim. Don't start. Look, you're not still sore because I didn't.
So is Prince Eric the hottest Disney prince?
Oh, Eric, it isn't me alone. The entire kingdom.
Because that's all he's got going for him. We know nothing about this guy other than, ooh, pretty.
I just haven't found her yet.
Well, perhaps you haven't been.
Okay, I want to talk to you about this upcoming line.
Believe me, Grim, when I find her, I'll know. Without a doubt, it'll just, bam, hit me. Like lightning.
Aside from him being able to summon weather like Storm from the X-Men, right. Is that how love works?
That you see someone and you just know and bam, it hits you?
Bam, like lightning. Because that to me sounds like infatuation more than love. Am I wrong in thinking that?
No, and I've heard people talk about when they met each other, they knew and they talked for several hours. And
well, I'm not saying you can't have sparks that leads to love immediately. Exactly. That can totally happen.
What are you munching on?
Chicago mix.
Because it's bringing two worlds together.
They've joined together and they're better as one than they were separate.
Every week you can eat the flavor that we are eating in that week's episode. Go to lisaspopcorn.com/...
Cinematherapy.
Cinematherapy and sign up for a subscription box and you have the option of choosing the box where you just get our hand-curated flavors that will go with that month's episodes. Part of what I do in couples therapy is I see what story couples are telling.
Okay.
Even if they're not in a great place, if the story of how they met and fell in love is still a positive, then it's generally easier to get them back there because there's something to build on.
Sure.
But sometimes people have the story like the story of us goes negative, where, well, I thought I was in love, but it was because they were deceiving me or because, you know, it was all a lie or this or that, or I was young and stupid or all these things. And so they retroactively kind of rewrite the story.
Yeah.
A similar thing happens when people fall in love and they stay in love and they stay happy is they will retroactively see when they met through the lens of love at first sight.
Yeah.
And the fact that you were attracted to somebody and felt a connection with somebody and you felt like you just knew that night. Yeah, but how many other times have you or somebody else, you met someone and you thought that night, I just know this is the one. And then a month later, you're like, that was not the one.
That did not work.
Right? And so it's confirmation bias. Mm-hmm. Eric also has very childish ideas of love. So, you know, just bam and I'll know. I'm so glad Frozen did the whole...
You can't marry a man you just met.
Disney needed that palate cleanser.
Really did.
Really, really bad. Eric's a looker, though.
He's handsome. I'd hold his hand.
Oh. Morning, Daddy.
I don't know why everyone was so upset about Clooney's nipples in Batman and Robin. Like, Triton's...
These are much more upsetting nipples.
These dark pepperonis.
What? What has she got?
Isn't it obvious, Daddy? Ariel's in love.
Ariel? In love? Hey, let's see now. Oh, who could the lucky merman be?
But he's totally cool with it. What? What?
So...
What? What's on your mind?
She's 16.
Mm-hmm.
Is he just a dog shit parent?
No, he's not, unless he's like... Time to pair her off for life.
If
he's
like, it seems like.
Yeah, but at the same time, this was the 1800s, and at the same time, this was underwater. Who knows how the rules work?
True.
There.
Yeah. That, hey. Okay.
Maybe
that's,
she
that's
has
on
the...
me. I judged a culture I don't understand.
I mean, how long exactly? Thank you. How long do fish last normally? A couple
how
years.
Long do fish and how last? Long? How they're long not do... fish. They're mer people.
Well, and then if mer people, if people last to like, you know, this time like 60, 70, and you like split the difference, maybe she's halfway through her life. No, I'm glad he's happy for her. If my daughter's in love at 16 and she's smart about it.
Oh, I'll be happy. I'll be totally happy for my daughter when she does that.
You know, if the guy's.
She will be in love at 16. You know, Audrey.
Yeah.
She'll be in love 12 times that year. It'll be real fun.
Not just any kiss. The kiss of true love. If he does kiss you before the sun sets on the third day, you'll remain human.
So back to the body dysmorphia. Here's what Ariel wants to be. And watch her face when she sees that she's a mermaid again.
Yep.
You belong to me.
No, Ariel!
Have we got a deal?
If I become human, I'll never be with my father or sisters again.
That's right. But you'll have your man.
Now that's a big jump. Falling, having feelings for him because she thought he was attractive, whatever.
Yeah.
But I'm going to leave my family. And I straight
up give up. I'm going to give up literally two of the three things in life I love the most. My family and my voice, so I can have the other one.
I mean, I was not smart as a teenager, but I never got to this level.
Yeah.
But it is just an animated film, so whatever.
You'll never even miss it.
That's not the attitude we go for.
No.
We expect better from our entertainment.
And animated films can have so much sophistication in their storytelling.
Zip.
But without my voice, how can I...
You'll have your looks, your pretty face. And
so Ursula...
is the greatest animated character of all time.
Yes, but there's a whole negative queer coding in Disney films of villains. I mean, she's modeled after a drag queen.
Yep.
Very famous drag queen.
Could you give us some of your political beliefs?
Kill everyone now. Condone first-degree murder. Advocate cannibalism.
Scar.
Oh, I shall practice my curtsy.
Like, and I could name many others. In fact, I did an entire master's thesis on gender roles in Disney and Pixar films. That was my master's thesis.
Yeah, yeah.
Everyone who is the hero or is the protagonist is very hetero, cisgendered, straight down the line. Which is why there's actually a ton of people in the queer community who celebrate the villains.
Yas queen, skinny legend, Versace boots, the house down. Slay queen, hunty mama, and oop daddy work.
But this brings me to the whole idea of body dysmorphism. A lot of people erroneously conflate that with transgenderism and say, well, you're dissatisfied with your body, you're focused on a specific body part that you will do anything to change, so that's... And here's the biggest difference. Transgenderism is about an identity. It's about who you feel you are at your core. It's not about an obsession with a body part, which is why body dysmorphia is quote-unquote a disorder to be treated therapeutically, and transgenderism is not.
Right.
It's about who am I and like bringing that out and showing that to the world.
Which can express as, you know, transitioning and going through hormone therapies and stuff, but it doesn't have to.
Yes.
Yeah.
And again, that would be part of it, like the bodily change, but it's focused on identity, not body.
You look wonderful.
Come, come, come. You must be finished. Let me help you, my dear.
As much as I don't love the whole voiceless storyline.
Hate it.
Ariel is super charming.
Oh, yeah. She's delightful.
I mean, with a voice, but also without a voice. There's just a real sweetness. You know what saves this movie for me is Les Poissons. Is the best thing I've ever seen in my life.
I want to talk to you about...
underage smoking? Whoa.
No, don't want to talk about underage smoking. I want to talk about the chef's clear anger management issues.
We should do an entire episode just on him.
Just a short...
So the concept of giving up your voice. There's a lot of people who love Little Mermaid and will defend it to death in our comment section, and we welcome that. Tell us why you would defend this.
Because you're wrong, though.
Well, what irks me is not that you can fall in love with somebody who is who's mute.
Oh yeah, no, that's ableist.
The idea is that they have no means to communicate and no means to know how they're going to build a life together.
Right.
And really no means to fall in love beyond hormonal attraction and some charm between them, right? Mm. Again, we talked about this in a different episode. If this were a story about him learning sign language or her teaching him sign language and they fall in love while communicating, that's a different matter entirely.
Totally.
But as it is, it very much feeds into the narrative. Like Ursula says, you have your looks, your pretty face.
And don't underestimate the importance of body language.
And then the film doesn't really do anything to negate that.
And then the film's like, yep, that's right. Absolutely.
Growing up in the 80s and 90s, especially in a fairly conservative religious culture as we did, there are a lot of parents who were very concerned about the seashell bras. and that it would trigger a sexual awakening in young boys, and they were right.
Sure did.
Yeah, so, but now, I mean, my wife is more concerned about our daughters taking that lesson from this.
Yeah, no, it's a horrible, horrible lesson. Just give up your voice and be pretty, and it'll be all work out for you.
Are we wrong? I don't think we are, but tell us in the comments how full of it we are and why. But you're going to have to actually, like, mount an argument.
Ariel! Okay. Wake up! Wake up! I just heard the news! Congratulations, kiddo! We did it!
What is this idiot babbling about?
Right, as if you two didn't know, huh? The whole
By the way, that shot was out of focus when they were filming the plate.
This afternoon!
Which is fun.
You know, he's getting married. You silly sidewalker. I just wanted to wish you luck. I'll catch you later.
Yeah, so, the main reason I wanted to talk about this, Ariel finds out, okay, I have 1 day left. I've been working this guy for 2 days on my...
It's a con.
It's a con. Uh-huh. I've been working this guy for 2 days. He's about to fall in love with me. I only have 1 day left because it's morning. She just got woken up in the morning, and he's going to get married at sunset. There's Ursula being evil, and what does she do all day? What does she do all day? What did she do for a whole freaking day? Why? This is the biggest problem with an admittedly quite problematic film. What the f*** was she doing?
Wow. She was probably taking a breakup nap on her mattress from helixsleep.com. She was probably enjoying some Le Poisson, drowning her sorrows.
She was binging.
So she was binge eating French food, which is actually a pretty great way to handle getting dumped. I will say, honestly, probably moping. I think that's the implication. But she just kind of immediately accepts that Eric found a new woman.
Guess
and
I lost.
I'm excited to see what they do with the remake.
I am too.
I'm wondering, especially because a lot of times with the remakes, they lean a bit more towards empowerment and more nuanced storytelling, not always.
Like, Cinderella definitely did. Aladdin gave Jasmine a lot more to do.
Yeah.
Honestly, if they want to tell a story that's even half relevant right now, they're going to have to do almost a page one rewrite. Like, keep some of the songs.
And we all know what happens. Like, the curse is broken and
By the way, through no fault of Ariel's, she does nothing. She swims to a boat and then, like, a bird does something and Eric does something and she goes, oh, I guess I'm safe now. Yay.
That's an issue with a lot of old school Disney is the female characters are passive.
Yeah.
Completely passive. The man determines how their life goes, or in this case, a seagull and a man, which is kind of doubly insulting. But she ends up with Eric, and Triton gives it his blessing, and there's a rainbow, which I just have so many questions for the queer community, like your interpretations of Little Mermaid, because I hope they're better than ours. So in real life, when it comes to hoarding and it comes to body dysmorphia, how do you work with that? The best treatment for both of those is cognitive behavioral therapy with a focus on finding a balance between the life that you want and the life that you have.
Sure.
Like loving the life that you have and building the life that you want. And you get too far out of balance in either direction. If you're so in love with the life that you have that you accept things that you probably shouldn't accept, that's out of balance.
Right.
And if you're so immersed in the life that you used to have or the life that you're looking forward to that you can't enjoy the moment, that's not living, right? And both her body dysmorphia, like how she looks, she wasn't satisfied with the fins. She didn't truly love herself. She wasn't okay with who she was. And with her situation, like Ariel was out of balance. And when it comes to her relationship with her dad, that would be, I could do two sessions of family therapy with them. I could sort that out.
Get it all fixed. Nice.
Yeah, because it really comes down to Ariel wants independence and she wants to be respected, and Triton just wants his daughter to be safe. And so it's about them having a conversation about what that looks like where they're both satisfied.
Okay.
And finding something together where probably Triton has final say because she's a minor, but the only way he's not going to have a behind his back rebellion is if he gives her a voice and he makes concessions so that she has a lot of say in
right,
the process
yeah.
as well.
Because giving her a voice and then completely overriding her every time, she might as well not have a voice. That doesn't matter.
Once she's 18, though, Triton, you did the best you could.
She's moving in with a grunge band, and they're going to travel around in a van.
So until next time, but Daddy, I love him!
And don't underestimate the importance of body language. Ha!
And watch movies. Dude, it was the ha! It was the ha with the hair over your face.
Didn't you play the flute, the cop, play the hop, the place, play the bass, and the sound, the chop, the bass, play the brass, the chop, play the tom, the flute is the Duke of Soul.